So yesterday we have seen some examples of Java programming. So today we will see some more, and today this session will wrap some more. So next session we will directly start Selenium programming. Okay, so last night we have seen F9 Java examples. That is inner class. F8, that is inner classes, right? So as a P9 is about writing a program Java that demonstrates the rules of calling constructors and overridden methods in a multi-level. So basically it's a combination of what we have seen earlier. Also we have seen multi-level inheritance separately and calling constructors separately, and so basically this combines both. So you said you are getting some Java errors in P8 or P7? Oh, P9, so we haven't touched the P9, so let me create classes. Sorry, what did you say? Okay, so let me try it. I can't hear you clearly. My voice or your voice? I think it's coming from your side.
But what noise is coming? There's nothing I'm doing.
Yeah, I think it's your. Can you unmute? Try to unmute. I won't get any noise. Yeah, now
it's.
Oh yeah. Now it's not coming. Okay, P9.
And I tried finding out about super keyboard. I just seen, whatever I read was that it is something related to inheritance, and it is used mostly in the child class. But
right.
What exactly super does, I am not understanding now.
Okay, for that we can just Google. For definitions, you can just Google. We have a lot of books also we can go through. So let's see what is super definition. Super.
Super definition, the sense, I think I should know what it is.
Yeah, so basically it refers to the super. It's parent class. If you are pointing to object in a super class, its parent class, then you use super without having to exactly point which one it is. So your method overrides one of its super class methods. You can this one.
So, but you know what? I saw
one
example when I was searching, and I saw two classes. One was the parent class, that was the parent class, and the child class.
So here, this is the simple single line definition. Super is Java, it's a keyword. So it refers to immediate parent's property. So property in the sense, whichever it is, method or variable. So immediate parent, not grandparent. So that's what it is. This refers to the current one, and the super refers to its parent one. So how do you know what is parent? You basically extend. When a child extends parent, that becomes its immediate parent. Simple. So here, this refers to parent's method. See, super dot get music. So here what we are trying to do, we are not creating any instance. There is no need of creating instance here. It just says, just access the immediate parent's method, whatever method we want to access, and execute it. That's what it means. Simple. This is always referring to the current one. Simple.
So suppose I have a tree structure, like I have a parent class, then I have a child class, and then I have another child class, which is the child of the upper one.
Uh-huh.
That is like that. So if I use in the last class, the last child class, if I use upper, then it will be referring to the class upper to it, not the first class.
Right.
One is the main class, then I inherited that class, and then I inherited the upper class. So if I, in the last class, if I use upper, then it is referring to the class previous to it, not the upper one, right?
Not the very upper one. So if you are referring to, for example, let me show you this example. So here P92 extends P91 and P93 extends P92, right? So obviously P93, if you are using super, this refers to P92 one, not the P91. P91 is the grandparent, obviously, because P93 extends P92, which in turn extends P91. So when you say super, this is directly referring to P92, not the P91. So that's simple meaning. So as far as this is concerned, like I told you, this can be used to invoke the current class constructor, current class, whatever class you are using. So when you say this in the P91, that means the current class constructor P91, this one, not any other, not super, not its grandparent, but its own own constructor. Simple, right? So this, okay. Remember that this always refers to the constructor in the current class, and super always refers to the constructor in the parent, immediate parent class. So let me write it down. P92 extends P91. Let me. P93 extends P92. Class P9, which calls these, when you say throws exception, you must have already imported the particular package, import IO exception package, java.io.io. So when something like this error is thrown, error is shown by it shows basically red color underline, so just hover over it and it shows the suggestion. So go for the first session, most likely it will resolve. So just here the problem is the particular package is not imported. So just if you click on it will automatically import the particular package. So let us try to run this and what's based on its output, let us try and understand. So that will be faster. So instead of spending a lot of time, I am trying to complete it faster.
For me, it's showing multiple markers at this line.
Okay, so that means you are getting error.
Yeah.
Okay, so this program is still running because it's showing red line, red color, this one. So let us see. Okay, so can you show me your screen, what exactly happening, so that I can resolve? Tell me your password so I'll connect to you. 6807. All right, so I can see your screen now.
Just a minute, I
where is P92, P93? Those classes are missing, right? Only P91
okay,
I can see.
Okay, I've copied and P91 only.
Okay, because you are trying to call P92 also. You are trying to instantiate P92 and it sees no P92 here. So that's what.
So I need to create P92 and all also?
Yeah, just create P92 and P93. Okay. But my, if you see my screen, it's still running the program, creating new P91 object D1 that is running inside P91 default constructor.
Yeah, earlier to this, whatever we were doing in the other program also, we were not creating different classes, right?
Yeah, this is not required. This is if you can't understand completely, that's fine. We will leave it. This is just to give you an idea, like I said. No need to spend too much time. So if you
I saw some few programs ahead related to threads and all. So
threads are not required. Yeah, this if you can you see my screen right now?
Yes.
So this is a example related to thread. Class thread implements runnable. So this is a kind, it's a core Java only, but it's not required for our automation. So we will skip it.
Okay.
Concept wise, I already learned this, but I never use threads and hashes and all those advanced things. So that's not a problem. Create two threads of same object and demonstrate. This is not required. Threads are normally used for in the actual the Java developer uses in to actually to incorporate multi-threading, multi-tasking functionality or feature in its program. So that's not required for our automation, since our automation is just to automate our own test cases, not the entire application. Okay,
and
demonstrate this.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Conceptually, what do you mean? Yesterday you told me what is final, I think. Final is just like we are declaring a constant. But there were some more keywords like finalize and finally.
So yeah. Final is a keyword that basically tells you that you cannot change the value of that variable. If a variable is final int v is equal to 6, that means its value throughout this program is final. It cannot be changed.
So what is the difference between final and static? Static, I think, means same, right?
No. There is a difference. That's a good question. What I would do is I'll directly go to Google and difference between
static and final.
Static and final in Java. So this is the best way to immediately resolve your question. So that's what I would do. Difference between static and final. I'm now beginner trying to know when I'm confused between static and final. Static means it belongs to the class, not an instance. This means that there is only one copy of that variable method shared between all instances of a particular class. Okay. So public static, okay, that means that it belongs to the class, not the instance. That means it wouldn't create multiple copies. There will be only one copy shared among all the instances of this particular class. Normally what happens if you when you create an instance of a class inside the JVM, JVM creates a small memory location in your hard drive. So that's what it happens inside in the binary level. So it, even if you do not call, even just by instantiating, it will create inside a memory location. That means it will occupy some memory basically. So when you call and everything, when your program is over, if you leave it without destroying that, it still occupies that memory, which basically causes your memory leakage problem and so on and so forth. So the best practice is to, when you finish your program, just close it or quit it or destroy that whatever memory location you are occupied by means of instantiating. So that's a best practice. So here static means it belongs to the class, my class, not the instance. That means you can create any number of instances of a class, right? My class C1 is equal to new my class, my class C2 is equal to new my class, blah blah blah. And you can also call to constructors by passing different number of arguments, whatever constructors you have defined inside the class. So what static means, it's not related to those instances, not C1, C2, C3, but it directly belongs to the class. So when there is only one copy of that variable method shared, that means it only shares one copy, not the multiple copies. So theoretically, if you don't understand, when you actually run this program, you will understand. So here you are creating one instance, second instance, right? So my class dot my variable is equal to 5. This change is reflected in both instances. So what I'm trying to do is, I am directly using class name here dot my variable. My variable is equal to 5. So this refers to, this means that it, if you are trying to use my variable value here 5, which is initially 0 and I made it 5, this affects both instances here. If you are trying to use this instance and calling some other function in which this my variable is used, both of those values will have 5. Simple. Okay. So if you don't understand, don't worry. So only by practicing you will understand later, or you can go through the different Java documentations, that way you will understand. But conceptually, this is simple as that. If you understand this line, you will understand what static means. This change is reflected in both instances. That means it is not having, these two instances are not having two separate copies, but they are having only one copy of, just by using this static. If you do not use static, both two separate copies will be shared by these two instances. So that is the difference. If you mention static, that means you are this particular thing has only one instance. Okay, my explanation, don't worry about my explanation. Conceptually, it is best to run this program and see it for yourself. That way you'll understand. Now final is entirely unrelated. It is a way of defining a once only initialization. You can either initialize when defining the variable or when the constructor, nowhere else. Okay. And note or final method, final clauses, this is a way of expediting the method clause, cannot be overridden, extended separately. Okay. One is final class. Okay. Final class is important. What it means that if you make a class final, that means it cannot be extended. That means you cannot create another class, class C, and extend that class which is final. That's what it is. Cannot be extended or overridden. Overridden means if a method is created in a final class, you cannot change its definition in another class. Normally overriding is, that's what it means by overriding, right? So you take that particular method and change its definition in the child class. That's what it means by overriding. When the final class is final, you cannot even inherit it. Obviously you cannot override its method. Simple.
Okay.
So that's right. This example, okay, don't worry about this one. Okay, finally is different. Finally is related to exception handling, try catch and finally, right? So it whatever the lines, Java program lines you mentioned, the try black, those will be executed when it is interrupted. For example, there are 10 lines in the try block, and fifth line it could execute successfully. Sixth line cause a problem.
Just a minute, somebody's at the door.
Okay, sure. So what I'll do is I'll simply copy this and paste it in our notes. So that next time we have to refer to this particular thing, we can directly go to here and use this. Okay, this is cumbersome, that's okay. Okay, so getting back to our program. Okay, this is also not significant, it's like cumbersome, so I'm terminating the program. So let us see this. P12 is also related to threads, so don't worry about this. P13, write a program in Java that handles exceptions. Okay, this is kind of related because we are going to use lot of exception handling, try catch blocks in our program. So let us try and understand. Even though it is simple, so let if you run it and by means of output, if you understand the program, so that will give you a practical idea. So what I'm going to do is I'm creating new package. So this is P13. Okay, so here what we are trying to do is we are creating a static method, static void throws illegal. Okay, exception. Okay, in the main, let us start with the main method first. In the main method, okay, we are calling a method which is in the same class, but it's in a different user defined method. This is a user defined method, so you can also apply this to the different class. So in that case, you have to create instance and call it using that. So we are calling in the try catch block, and this will be tried. And if there is any exception in executing the lines of this P method occurs, then it will jump to this catch and throw this exception. And simply we are trying to catch that exception data here caught, and E will contain all the exception data that will be printed onto console. Then finally it will jump to this one. So this is the final. Finally it jumps to this one and it just prints. After catching the exception, it goes to finally. So this is a normally, after finally it won't go back again. So basically this is the end, like the name suggests, it will be end. So if you want to know more about try catch block, it's the good site is Stack Overflow. Like we saw another examples. If you just go into stackoverflow.com, just type try catch block in Java, try catch finally. Package finally written, qualification Java. Okay, the final log. This is a good side. Okay, by reading all the questions already asked related to, I thoroughly understand. Finally gets always. Finally is always called. That's the significance. Finally, no matter what, finally will be entered and it will be executed. So that is the main significance. That means if you want some piece of code to be executed at any cost, put it in the finally block. So try catch, okay, and finally. So that's the main significance. Like for example, okay, I'm not getting example. Okay, gets always called exception from system exit and infinite loops. Okay, except from system dot exit and infinite loops. If it goes to infinite loop, it won't end finally. And system exit, normally you can programmatically you can exit from system using some command, so in that case also it won't end finally. However, I would like to know if a return is called in catch block.
But when will we use try catch? Like suppose going to write a program and but I don't know when shall I use try catch.
Try catch, that's a good question. Okay, so if you think that the data you are using is going to cause problem, then it's best practice to use try catch. In our programs, we always use try catch, okay. Because if you don't know what happens in the execution, by you might pass some data. For example, best example is dividing by 0. If you divide a number by 0, it's undefined, right? So you have written a method for dividing two numbers, and by mistake or something, you have passed the denominator as 0. The denominator cannot be zero. Mathematically, it's not defined or infinite. But computer would not calculate it. By it simply throws an exception. A number cannot be divided by zero exception or something like that. So if you do not put that particular calling in the try catch block, your whole program will be terminated and it will throw the exception like you have seen in the previous P8 example or something. So that's not a good thing.
Okay.
So when you see something, all. Even if you don't see anything, just for the recovery scenario purposes, put it in the try block, and if something happens with some test data error or something, it will directly go to catch block and just return that whatever the exception data is there, it will just print it to console so that you can take a look at that later. But it will not stop your execution, but it will continue to execute until your end of line, till the last line it will continue. So that's it. But if you want, even if it throws some exception, but if you want some lines to be executed at any cost, then you introduce finally. You put finally and put that code in the finally. So finally is optional. If you don't put finally, it doesn't matter. But if you have some code, even if the exception occurs, if you still want it to be executed, not dividing by zero, something like that, but if you still want it to be executed, the valid code, then put it in the finally. So that will be.
Okay.
executed it in a cast. So now you understand the significance of try catch and finally, right? Try catch at least.
So it may be useful for giving to the developers also that stat which we are getting.
No, not really. Our automation is just for ours. If you are getting exception in your automation program, that's not something developer can look into because it's your own botheration, right? It's your problem. So basically, you have to try and understand the exception. I will tell you how to handle, how to go through the exception data and what, how to figure out what, where the error is and how to resolve that error in your code. So that's all. So the exception the developer gets when in the WebSphere application server or something, that is related to his own. Normally manual testers manually test it, and for example if SOAP message is run, suddenly he gets an exception message. Or if you go to some pages in the web application, suddenly some web service is invoked. And it throws basically maybe it's the federal hub services, some hub services that are hosting these web services are down for some reason, then it throws some exception and just prints that exception onto web page, next page. Okay, this particular service is down right now, currently at the moment, please try again later. So basically he is printing that exception, whole exception into that page. Sometimes he just dumps the whole exception.
Yeah.
So, then what manually tested is capture that exception, takes a screenshot and okay, goes to developer, raise a defect and talks to this because that's a developer's exception. Here, the automation exception is our problem. So, developer cannot do anything about it. But if you want to get an idea, if you are close with some developer, you can talk to him just to get an idea. That's a good practice. So, okay, this article also explains about try catch finally return clarification in Java. This is a good site. So go to this. Normally what I'll do is I'll just bookmark. So instead of bookmarking, apart from bookmarking, I will also put this, instead of going to this again and again, I'll just put this in my notes so that you can go through it later. Normally you won't get you will get some doubts right now, but when we are actually writing our automation program, if you get lot of doubts, we can directly go to our notes and just look into the, just control F and see what is there. So that's a good idea. That will save time, lot of time. That's what I do. So here I am going to put this in. So this is right. Keep it simple. Instead of going into very deep, just keep it simple so that you don't bother about the Java programming. Just bother about your automation. Okay, now let us try to take a look at this program. Okay, this particular is related to the previous example. Just clear it. And
Here it is written
through
new, and in the
language
it is written demo. What is this demo?
Okay, so let me explain that. Here, I am trying to call this in the try block, some method, right? Since it's in the same class, I don't have to use instance. Directly you can call, just what it is. And in the catch, I am throwing illegal access exception E. And just printing it. Finally, I want to just print this one. Okay, that's okay. Now let us take a look at the P method. What is the P method definition? P method definition is simply printing something system out.println inside P. That means it is entering P just to know. And it's throwing new illegal access exception with this demo. You can put whatever string you want inside. So it just throws this exception. So when it actually executed, first it goes to try. Okay, now it is calling this P. Now it goes to this and it is simply printing this line. Okay, that's what it did. Then it is simply throwing, you are deliberately throwing. Normally in your real-time situation don't throw it. This is just for the example sake. You are deliberately throwing a new illegal access exception. It might be anything. Accidentally you might get some other exception. So here we don't, instead of waiting for that exception, we are deliberately throwing some exception. Okay, now to see what happens. So obviously it will catch, since it is throwing exception, it will enter the cache block, right? Then it executes this one. What we are executing is some sysout cart, okay? Then what is the exception data? It will exactly print. The exception data is java lang.illegal exception demo. This exactly is being printed here. The exception name is, complete name is java.lang.illegal_exception, complete name. Then you are printing demo. So that's how the E, the this is the actually the data of the exception, which is this one, because you are deliberately throwing it, which is being printed here. Since now cache block is over, now since you are used finally, optional finally, it will definitely enter finally. Whatever you are doing here, it will be executed. So exactly that is being executed. This is the simplest, most effective program for explaining try cache block. If you understand this one, you can use it effectively in your program. So tell me, Prachi, did you understand it or any questions in this one?
I understood it, but I didn't understand why it appended demo word. See,
okay.
Let me tell you what I understood is it went in main and it executed the P function. And for P, it was system outing that inside P, that's fine. Then we are calling, in P only we are calling this throw new whatever. That's an exception. So we will go to the cache block. Then we are system printing this caught. Caught what has come, okay. Now plus E means we are appending to it the exception which we got. So we appended that exception which we got. But now why did we print this demo word here?
No, that is just for, okay, now you have understood correctly, don't worry about it. This is just to see what is happening in the console. You don't have to print anything here. Simply to see that what is actually going, if I run this one, you simply don't see any demo, see. It is just throwing cart and the exception name, exact exception name, that's it. E is the exception name. So if you want to see what is exception, then you can click on it and blah blah. You can just go to this exception in the Google it, and you will see what is the exception details and everything. Let's not bother about that one. So why we have put demo? Because we want to see, okay, it actually entered this illegal exception and throwing that exception, including, normally this takes an optional string argument. So here you can enter anything just for your understanding purposes. This is not really mandatory. So here whatever you enter there, it will just append that exception name. That's it. So caught.
Yeah.
And so realistically this is not good. You don't throw the exception like this, right? So when you get an exception, it will enter the cache block and it will print the exception matter so that you can take a look at it later at the debugging purposes. So that's what happens in the real time. So don't worry about it. So here all we are trying to do is we are putting some line, some code which might cause an exception. Here it will definitely cause an exception because we are throwing it deliberately just for our example purpose. So that's why you are putting in the try block. But just because you have doubt that it might throw exception, but even though you think it doesn't throw any cause any exception problems, still it is a best practice to put in a try block. But you never know, because of the test data also your automation program might be abruptly ended. So, and then catching this here, you don't have to put anything. This is purely optional. Just catch it. So here if I run this one, simply it wouldn't do anything. It wouldn't do anything. Simply it enters the finally and executes it. Finally is not mandatory too. So let's see what happens. Simply it will do nothing. Just inside P and that's it. Right?
Yeah, but throw new is
different,
something like that. Or it's
same
thing, throw new and throw.
Oh, you mean to say throws?
Throw, yeah.
Yeah, throws is you are throwing this particular exception. Okay, let me do some more. Here, I want to print the exact data of the exception. So this is another way. e dot print stack trace. So even if you run this one, it e dot print stack trace not only prints the exception name, but its complete data. So like this. So you exactly know what line is, what line of your code is causing problem. P13. Okay. So this is causing problem. So obviously you go there and correct it. Why it is causing problem? Because you are deliberately throwing the exception. In real situation, it might be real problem. So in this case, you go there and do some modifications, blah blah blah. So that's a good thing. If you don't do anything, that's fine too. It will simply cache and continue to execute the rest of the program. Okay. Now it may not be illegal. This is the particular exception. Sometimes you don't know the what kind of exception will occur. Only if you guess, make an educated guess, you know exact exception name, then you will throw this. Otherwise, you can just throw an exception. Simply an exception. Because you don't know what kind of exception will occur, right? So here, yeah. I want to throw, okay, just for the example purpose, I want to throw simple exception. Okay, this is not required. And here, I am simply calling this. Okay, now it is showing you have to add throws declaration here. So here, keep in mind that when your method throws exception, your main method that is calling that method should also throw an exception. Simple. Otherwise, it will cause problem. So now let us see if we run this program, what will be the output. Simply same thing, whatever we expected. Inside P exception in the main. And this, and here javaland exception, and it shows exception where the exception occurs in the exact line. So the exception is at this point and this point. So you go there and correct it. So don't worry about this. If we spend more time than this, it will be waste of time. So when we are actually writing our automation programs, I'll explain more on this. Okay, so let's close this. P13 is over. Just want to see what else. Write a program in Java that makes use of nested try blocks. So, okay, this is try within a try, which is highly unlikely in our automation. But I don't want to run this one. Just try and understand here itself. So, try block, within try block, you are using another try block. That is purely for developers. Don't worry about it. We won't do this one. And P14 to nested try blocks. Okay, same thing. Okay, this will, even if you just open this file, it will just give you an idea. Okay, that means, okay, nested try blocks exist. Okay, that concept is there. So if you just understand this one, that's fine. Implement the producer consumer problem that uses a common buffer having in terms of the method wait and notify for proper. Okay, don't worry about the whole program. The wait is important. What is wait? What is used? What is wait used for? Do you know, Prachi? Okay, that is correct. Yeah, that's exactly correct. So normally I'll just explain it further. So what happens in the automation execution time, runtime is your application might be slower because of environmental issues or something. Then, but your program, automation program, your application is slower, but your automation program has some definite timeout periods. Let's say between two operations, it can wait 20 seconds, no more than that you have set, or there is a default value for timeout period. So every time it executes, clicks on the next button, waits for 20 seconds, no matter what, waits for 7 seconds, or it might go if it finds the next element, immediately go it. If it doesn't, still trying to find the element, then it will wait for 20 seconds, then until even if after 20 seconds it couldn't find particular element in your application because of different issues, application might not have that element at all, or its properties might have been updated, changed or something, because of various issues the find element couldn't find that particular element that is used for some purpose, dot click or dot whatever. So what happens is, it simply throws an exception, element not found exception, and that's it. Your execution program execution is ended. Now you are suspecting that the particular object is taking more time than expected to come into existence in that particular case. Not 20 seconds, but it is taking 30 seconds. So in that case, what you would do is you simply use wait. So normally, thread is the class which has wait, built-in wait method. You don't have to explicitly define it. So simply thread.wait and followed by 30 or number of milliseconds, I guess. So this would wait for 3 seconds, something like this. So that is the significance of wait. So basically it is used for the synchronization purpose. Okay. Now that just knowing this, but this much is enough for right now, and we don't have to go through this program anymore. So P15 is that one, file copy program. Okay. So this is like you are dealing with files, flat files in your program. Like you are opening a file input stream and like reading from the file, writing to the file, appending to the file, blah blah blah. You can do all these three operations in combination or separately. So if you are doing something like that, then you have to use. But since if you are not writing anything to file, you don't have to worry about. So right now, for the time being, I am closing it. But you just you have these copies, right? So just in P16, you just change its name so that you know later. So P16 hyphen, call it file input stream, something like this. So next time you just go to this folder, you know exactly what it is. So next time if you come across this, a file input thing in our automation, you can directly go this understand later. So that's for P16 and P19. Okay, this look like overloading constructor method, passing by reference. Okay, passing by value, call by reference, you know, right? In C, if you know the C language, you know call by value and call by reference. Pointers, so that's more or less related to pointers. So here class A has two variables, constructor A is equal to B is equal to 0, and A another constructor overloading integer X. Okay, A is 0, A is equal to, O dot B, void show, you are sussing out, and class B extends A, integer C, B, super, so that refers to the A, which is parents constructor, B, overloaded, B. Okay, so basically you are passing the B method, like you are passing instance of B, class B. So super B you are passing. I don't see any significance of this one, so let us leave it same thing that whatever we have seen earlier. P20 cell head is equal to new cell. Data input stream. Okay, so same thing, data input stream is being used here. So just rename the file as data input stream. We'll see it later. Write a program in Java that implements the operators. Okay, the logical operators, greater than, less than. Okay, this is a simple program. If you want to just run it, let us run it. So there are different operators in Java, right? Java provides Boolean operators, logical operators, mathematical operators, blah blah blah. So let us see the significance of this I less than 1. Even I have forgotten. So let's see. P21. I is equal to 5. Okay. Now I is equal to I less than 1. So what exactly it is doing when you print next time? It is what is exactly being done here? I value is 5, then its value is doubled.
Okay. I less than 1 is doubling.
Yeah, that's what I'm wondering. that may be the meaning of it. Doubling means it's multiplying the number with the same number. Okay. One time. Okay. Then its value becomes 10. Next, multiplying the 10 with the same number. Not the same number. No. Multiplying by 2. Okay. Or adding 2 times, you can call it. So that will double the 10. Okay. Then I is equal to 5. Again, you are resetting. Greater than 1. So that will just add 1. And I is equal to 5. Greater than 1. Call it. Okay. So don't worry about this one. We don't use this type of operators in Morpheus. So if you want to just explore what it is, operator in Java. Bitwise operators, logical operators. Yeah, binary left shift operator. Okay, this definitely we don't use this. The left operand value is moved left by the number of bits specified by the right operator. Okay, don't worry about it. P21. Write a program in Java that implements variable multi-dimensional arrays. Okay, this is a good example. So, two-dimensional is most we can use, but let's try and understand multi-dimensional, that will give us an idea. Okay, so here directly in the main method, without going to creating another methods, directly we are seeing this example in main. So here we are creating a two-dimensional array of integer type. So you know the syntax, right? Int or float or whatever string a followed by these two things will mean that it's two-dimensional array, and we are creating new int 22. So 22 is the number of first index will have 2, second index will have 2. That means size of this particular array is 2 by 2, which is 4. So do you know that it starts with a 0 or 1, the array? 0, right? So what is the size of this array then? So that would become 3 by 3, right? Okay, so now since you are dealing with arrays, you have to use those arrays in the for loop. So for loop, depending upon the the dimension of array, if you are using two dimensional array, you have to use two nested for loops and blah blah blah. Three dimensional array will take 3 nested for loops. One dimensional array will take just 1 for loop. So based on the number of nth number, if you are putting n is equal to 1, then use that many number of for loops. So that's the bottom line. So for integer I is equal to 0, I less than 2, I plus plus. So basically it will start from 0 index and it will go until 0, 1. So not 2. Okay. Okay. My mistake. The size of array is 2 only, because that is static. Even though the index of the array starts from 0, so it ends at 1, 0, 1. That's what it means. So basically it's 1 by 1, 2 by 2 only, 4. So you're creating another nested for loop with a different index j is equal to starting from 0, and you can say is less than or equal to 1 or less than 2. Both means both would mean the same. J plus plus, that would counter, increase its counter by 1. So what you are doing inside this, you are simply allocating the array's element. Array will have 1 1 like this. If you want to see, let me just so this is called 1 comma 1. Okay, in our Arrays language it's 0 comma 0 index wise, right? And this is the first row, right? And second column, and this is the second row, first column, and first row, first second row, second column. Okay. So this is what exactly being utilized inside for loop. So AII, first of all it takes A00. So what it would be taking the value, first of all, I is equal to 0 plus 1 1 plus J is equal to 0 plus 1 1 1 plus 1 is equal to 2. So this IA11 will have 2 here for the first time. So then it goes back to this particular loop. Which loop? It won't go to the outermost loop. It will loop inside the innermost loop until this particular condition is not satisfied. Then only it will go to the outermost loop, right? That's how the mechanism works. Okay. Now J is equal to 0. Then immediately J is equal to 1 is increased. By 1 it is increased. Now I value remains 0. J 1. So which we are dealing with? This one, right? So next time, yeah. what happens, I value still remains a 0, 0 plus 1, 1 is 1, then 1 plus 1, 2, 2 plus 1 is 3, so this will be 3. So now J is equal to 2, so and the condition is not satisfied, it comes out of this loop, but it goes to the outermost loop. Then I value is increased by 1, so I becomes 1. Now here, it comes again, J is equal to 0. So this time I 1, J 0. So we are dealing with this particular cell. Though I 1, 1 plus 1, 2, and 0 plus 1, 1, 2 plus 1, 3. So this will have 3. So I am not saying because you don't already have knowledge about it. It is, if you understand this like this one time and leave it, then next time you can use it effectively. So that's the reason why I'm saying. So then A is equal to 2 it becomes, and J is equal to A is equal to 1, and then J is equal to 1, both would point to this particular one. And what is the value? 1 plus 1 plus 1 plus 1, which is 4. So simple. So if you understood this like this clearly, for at least for now, and then you can effectively use what exactly means inside, how to use it, and blah blah blah. Okay, then what we are doing, we are creating another for loop here, right? This for loop ended here. This is not a nested one. So this is a second one. So here what we are doing, integer I is equal to 0, I less than 2, I plus plus, blah blah blah. Simply you are changing its executable statement here. Instead of putting something, you are sissing out something. Okay, so basically here you are not printing it to console, you are taking it and whatever you calculated, it will put it inside its memory location, then in the next for loop, you are printing it out everything. So that's why these four lines have resulted in console. Now, without using this extra two for loops, can you do the same thing right here? Can you just put it sys out right here? Instead of wasting two more for loops?
Yeah, we could have done there only. Why we use this second one?
We could have done it. We don't have to, but let me see if it works. So, I'll just comment out. Yeah. Same thing. So basically that is just to give it was two for loops are used just to avoid the confusion maybe, but it works exactly the same way. You just hold the values and print it right away. Here in this previous example, you are holding these values in all the cells, then you are printing it. So that means that it is capable of holding the values. So it won't erase the values. Basically, this will give you an idea. Like, okay, it is holding the values and their previous values are not getting erased and new values are getting going there. So it will hold the values, or if you are just printing out, realistically this is better way. But if you are understanding the concept, this is better way. Okay. So P22 is simple. Okay, this is an applet thing, so we don't deal with applets, don't worry. P24 is what is the P24? Can you figure out what is exactly conveying? Okay, you are instantiating to into class three times with three different constructors, and OC dot add you are accessing add. Okay, OA dot. Okay, this is a simple example that we have already seen, so skip it. Okay, let's see what this can give us a good idea about new concept. Time, okay, void display, you are displaying the time in hour, minute, second format. Add time, you are adding time. Okay, these type of examples are good. Normally in your for example, in your automation, you might need to display the time, or you want to add the time. For example, for example you create your account, and after creating account you might need to wait for like 5 minutes before actually using that account for logging purposes, because of the fact that normally server takes time to update database and everything. So in such case, instead of waiting, automation wise you cannot wait, right? So programmatically you can wait like by adding time. So in such cases it might be good idea to utilize these programs. So you just let us keep this as is instead of trying it right now. So what I would do is I'll just time related functions. Okay, next time I can use it. Para Sunios. Okay, this is not required for us. Graphics AWT, that's what is called a window toolkit. Demonstrating inheritance and interfaces. Interfaces is not required. Inheritance we have already seen by means of the extends parent, child extends parent class, and blah blah blah. So interfaces are not required for us. Okay. So not required. Okay, this is kind of required. So you want to get the absolute path of a file. Okay, let us try and see. So for this you have to import the java.io package. Okay, so exactly what is being done here in the main, you are creating a file using the file class, directly instantiating it. AA, so it will directly create it in the C folder, inside A folder, and inside A folder. So let us check it out whether it has created or not. C folder. Okay, it is not creating, my mistake. It is basically printing the absolute path of this one. Okay, so absolute path means you are basically avoiding the initial for example your file is or folder is in the C drive. So this is the complete path, right? This is the absolute path. But relative path is this one. So that means that it is understood, okay, the C drive, the root drive, which is C drive in our Windows system, has A drive, A folder, in which there is another folder. Now this is just to simply print its absolute path. In Unix system, it starts with root, root slash A dot slash, A slash A. So this is just a simple example, so we don't need to use it. Definitely this is not required. Action listener applets, no. Nested try statements we have already seen. AWT is not required for us. Okay, lost. Okay, so this is also not. So whatever we have learnt in Java, that's more than enough. So if you have time right now, Prachi, we can continue with Selenium, or we can continue in the evening. What do you say?
We can continue in the evening. What time you want? Yesterday ping at 6 o'clock. I was sleeping
that. Okay. Normally I go out 6 o'clock. If you want the class at 7 o'clock, we can. 7:30 is best time, I guess. But if you start 7:30, if you spend at least 2 hours, we can finish something. 1 hour is not enough, right? So 7:30 to 9:30, what do you say?
No.
7 o'clock.
7 o'clock. Okay.
Okay, 7 to 8:30, 1.5 hours.
Okay.
Okay, so you have no time, right? You have to go pick up your child. Okay. So that's what I thought.
So,
okay then. Yeah.
We were discussing that we have only in afternoon, but now also in the evening we'll be having every day.
Not only till this Monday, because Monday I'm traveling to Pennsylvania. So only till Monday I have time. Not after that. So that's why I'm trying to utilize as much time as we can right now.
So we will not have classes.
Monday we will have class. So my job starts like next Monday, not this Monday. Next Monday I'm traveling, Monday or Tuesday. So once I go there and settle down, so I can still start taking classes. But once my project starts, like December 22nd, then it will again take some more time for me to settle down in the project, right? So maybe, hopefully we'll finish by then, but if you don't finish, if there are any backlogs, then I'll try to complete with like after 1 week or something, or on Saturdays, Sundays, so don't worry about it. My main project is Selenium related only, so I'll definitely, if I get any updates in my new project, I'll definitely share with you, so I'll update you. So these are just beginning, basics we are learning, so we haven't even entered Selenium, so once we enter, we will rigorously look into that, the framework and everything.
Okay.
Okay, then.
Today at 7 o'clock, right?
Yeah, I'll talk to you at 7 o'clock.
Okay.
Okay, bye.